Do these grounded wrist straps slow you down and chain you to your bench?
Where's my coffee?
Static electricity. It's good for more than just blowing up your device under test. You can also use it to blow up your test gear. What fun! Hi, I'm Daniel Bogdanoff, and today we're gonna look at four easy ways you can blow up your test gear with ESD or the wrong inputs. It happens to people all the time. Don't believe me? Just ask our repair department, who may or may not have asked me to make this video, or the opposite of this video, I don't remember. When they asked me to make a static video, I told them that's literally just a picture, and the whole conversation went downhill from there. Anyways, electronic damage to test gear is caused by an excessive amount of power going into an equipment's inputs, and that power gets there in a few different ways. If you want to blow up your test gear, follow these tips. Before we dig in, we have a free checklist you can download that covers each of these tips, so you can have a memento of the time we're about to spend together. Even better, subscribe to this channel and we can do it again sometime. Or if you've already subscribed, give the video a like and we can keep this thing going. And finally, we have three extra bonus tips at the end of this video, so make sure to watch the whole thing. Without further ado, here's tip number one. The easiest way to blow up test gear is to hook up just any old signal without knowing its characteristics. Sure, a test gear's data sheet lists the maximum input parameters, and sure, equipment has built-in protection mechanisms and will often warn you if you're about to go outside the spec, and sure, we even print the max input rating on the gear right next to the inputs. But one simply cannot build a sensitive measurement device that can also take any input safely. That piece of test gear doesn't exist, and you can even damage your equipment without ever seeing a warning. The responsibility to protect your gear is on you. So I have this 12 kilovolt neon sign transformer and this 9 volt battery. One of these is a safe input and one of these is not. Let's figure out which is which. Let's start with the 12 kilovolt neon sign transformer. Actually, I'm just kidding. I don't want to die, and more importantly, I don't actually want to blow up my equipment. To avoid blowing up your equipment this way, don't exceed the maximum input power or voltage on your gear. Also, when connecting to an unknown signal, start at the lowest sensitivity and work your way down to the signal. Essentially, you always want to keep your signal completely on the screen. But did you know you can also expose your equipment to 10 kilovolts or 12 kilovolts quite easily without the help of this death transformer? Here's how. You've probably heard the phrase treat yourself, but if you want to blow up your equipment, it's time to float yourself. Throw caution to the wind. If your feet aren't buried in wet sand at the beach or your wrist isn't shackled to a properly grounded ESD mat, odds are you're high voltage, which is the perfect way to blow up your test gear. I can charge myself up just by walking around, and then we can watch this charge transfer into the board. If I'm grounded, it doesn't happen. Do these grounded wrist straps slow you down and chain you to your bench? Well, if you want to blow up your test gear, you can just take it off. Or you can get one of these cheap wireless anti-static wristbands like I did. Or get six. I think six will work better. Or if you're classy, like me, you can get a fancy wireless anti-static band. Because it costs more than one of those corded bands, it must work better, right? According to the seller's description, these can even make a nice anniversary gift. I'll let you know how that works out for me. As you can see with our ESD meter, an ungrounded person or person with a wireless ESD band can have charge. The charge is then transferred right into the equipment or to an ungrounded conductor. Then, when this board is connected to equipment, it can damage the gear. Trust me, at the end of the day, not using protection will have unintended long-term consequences. So go ahead, handle your gear without proper ESD precautions. But to avoid damage, make sure your mat is properly grounded and use corded ground straps. Mats can be grounded via a ground connection on the instrument, which is preferred, or through a ground cube plug, or the ground screw on an outlet. Make sure your ground wire won't accidentally touch to hot also. I should also point out that it only takes a couple hundred volts to damage some gear, but you only feel it when you're well above 1 kV. Granted, this is an obvious way to do damage, but the next few might be new to you and are all related to static field induction. If you aren't careful, your boards can charge up via induction and then zap your gear. Take, for example, this cart. It's pretty common for folks to need a little extra bench space and put the boards and gear on an insulated material like this. But watch, if we jiggle the cart around a little bit or just give it some of the positive reinforcement it so desperately needs.
Good job, cart. Way to be, cart. Yeah, cart.
It charges up. In this case, it's charged up to well over 10 kV. When you put your board on it, the charge equalizes and normalizes so they both end up charged thanks to induction. Your body can also charge up and transfer that charge to your board. Then you innocently go to hook up your charge device to your test gear and boom! And then we'll do a little explosion or something. So, tip 3 for blowing up your test gear is to use an insulated or high resistance material as a platform for your interface boards and devices. It's not just big carts like this either. All kinds of high resistance materials build up an electrostatic field. Using our handy electrostatic field meter, we can see that this material charges up to over a kV. You don't want that going into your test gear. To avoid this damage, keep charged materials at least a foot away from your boards and use appropriate materials. If you're transporting boards, you should also completely seal them up in static shielding bags so they don't charge up during transport. It's not just boards you have to watch out for though, your cables can also cause damage. Believe it or not, the center conductors of your cables themselves can build up a charge through induction from a board or surrounding fields. Remember this from last tip? This is bad, bad thing to do. So, to blow up your test gear, just grab a cable at random and connect it up to your gear without discharging it first. If you want to avoid this damage, you should first discharge your cables before using them, and here's how you do that. First, make sure your device is not powered. Second, connect one end of the cable to your device. Then, grab the other end of the cable and connect it to a 50 ohm shunt, or you can use a short and a pinch. This connects the center conductor and the outer shielding, effectively discharging the center conductor. Finally, remove the shunt and immediately connect up to your test gear. And there you have it, 4 easy ways to blow up your test gear. However, because we're a little bit extra sometimes, here are 3 super quick Keysight bonus tips for keeping your gear safe. Sometimes you need to be extra cautious, especially when working with exposed assemblies. A good ESD mat has a resistance in the 10 to the 8th ballpark, which is often pretty good insulation, but if this isn't enough, use standoffs to keep your board off the mat. This lets an air gap be your insulator and ensures that your exposed board assemblies don't have any unexpected paths to ground. Who knows what fun that could cause? Pink packing material pretends to be static safe, but often it's not. To be safe, simply don't use it for your boards and instead use ESD approved mats, standoffs, and packaging. We grabbed these 3 random pink foam pieces from around the building here, and you can see in our meter that they each have a charge, it's potentially damaging, and the charge on these is all different. If you aren't using a channel, cap it. This helps avoid incidental contact that could lead to ESD trauma. Now, obviously you don't want to blow up your test gear, so we've put together a handy free checklist that you can throw up on your cubicle wall as a reminder of what you should be doing. There's a link for that download in the description, but it all comes down to the fact that equipment is damaged by excessive input power. Avoid it at all costs. Stay within the rated input range. Use a grounding mechanism for yourself and your work surface. To be extra safe, use a little checker like this to make sure you're grounded before handling anything on your bench. And finally, handle boards and cables properly. This means keeping charged materials at least a foot away from your boards, using standoffs, proper materials, and proper discharging techniques. Thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe to this YouTube channel, download the free ESD checklist, and put your worst ESD story in the comments so we can commiserate with you. I'm Daniel Bogdanoff, and I'll see you next time.
Good cart. You're doing such a great job. Good job, cart. Way to be, cart. Yeah, cart. Okay.